Interpretive Park Ranger Dave Byers, the Lowell National Historic Park, and is the Society's guest speaker this evening. He'll talk about the history of Lowell's power canal system and the city's water-powered textile mills and their role that helped spark the Industrial Revolution in this area. Well, before becoming a park ranger in Lowell 4.5 years ago, Dave worked at the Boston National Historic Park, at the Mark Twain House in Connecticut, and at the Old York Historical Society in York, Maine. As an interpretive park ranger here, Mr. Byers staffs local various locations in the park, including the Visitor Center, the Boot Cotton Mills, and the Mill Girls and Immigrants exhibit. He handles historical questions, gives short interpretive talks, helps visitors connect their modern day visit to Lowell with Lowell's other historic experiences. He also conducts canal boat tours and trolley tours, man of all means, and walking tours, and manages the park's digital media team. So we're grateful that Dave's taking a time out to come over and talk with us tonight. So welcome, Dave. Okay.
Connect this up here. Somewhat undignified.
All right.
Keeps it out of the way, right?
Hear the silence out there. Problem is, my belt is too thick. I put it in my pocket. There we go. Alrighty, well, good evening. It's a pleasure to be here with you tonight. I'd like to thank the Bedford Historical Society for inviting me to talk about one of my favorite topics. Is that... Okay. Oh, yeah. I might need that. And that is Lowell National Historical Park. I just want to applaud your efforts to put together the Bedford Historical Museum. It's in really places like that that really keep our history alive. I remember growing up on the South Shore in Abington, and there's a little local historical society, the Dyer Library. And as a young kid going in there with my parents searching for genealogical information, I discovered stories about these sort of shoe shops that would show up in the backyards in places like the South Shore and like the North Shore and in places like Lynn. Stories about abolitionists gathering in Island Grove Park there. And it really ignited a spark in me, I think, that really got me excited about history and finding all of these stories, so many of them and so many people that have passed through towns, small and large, and cities. And it's really in those places that you really keep that spark alive. So I applaud your efforts to put a local historic museum together. And now I'm excited to work in a place with a lot of amazing stories, and that is Lowell National Historical Park. How many people have visited Lowell? Okay, all right, so pretty good. So some of you will recognize this scene that we have in front of us. This is the Boot Cotton Mills Museum. First of all, everybody hear me okay? All right. If it gets if I get too quiet or too loud, let me know. And if you have any questions as we're going along, feel free to hold up your hands. I'd be happy to answer them there, or just shout them out. That'll work too. So this is the Boot Cotton Mills Museum, right in one of the best preserved mill complexes in Lowell. Lowell is a pretty special place. Lowell is the first large-scale industrial planned city in the country, and the history that we preserve there and talk about there really centers on the American Industrial Revolution. That Industrial Revolution changes everything. It changes the way we live. It changes the way we work, the way we play. Changes the language. In some cases, languages people speak in different communities. And that change affects the entire country and eventually the entire world. And Lowell is right at the center of that story, is that first large-scale industrial planned city. And so people often come into the park and ask, why is that? Why Lowell? Why this place? Why should it become so important? And what I'd like to talk to you tonight is about why it is that Lowell becomes such an important part of the American Industrial Revolution. And I want to talk about these four streams that come together in a unique way in the city. Nature, capital, guys with money, labor, the workers that are doing all the work, and especially technology. And I'll talk a little bit more about technology at the end than maybe some of the others there, because Lowell is a really special place for innovation, kind of the Silicon Valley of its day. Lots of innovations come out of Lowell, spread throughout the industry, and then spread throughout the country, and eventually spread around the world. So that's what I'd like to talk about today, and a little bit about what you can come to see and do at the park if you were to come and visit us. But it sounds like lots of you already have. How many people have taken one of our canal boat tours? All right. So some of this will be familiar. Has anybody had me as a tour guide? All right, good. So there'll be some new things here. I've got some props. I'm going to try to keep in the video screen, so I'm going to try to walk around and use those. All right, so first off in our elements, we have, of course, nature. And nature is best represented by the Merrimack River. This is the river that that runs around Lowell. It runs all the way out through Lawrence and through Haverhill, eventually out to Newburyport. And this is really the whole reason that Lowell exists. Some of you might be familiar with where the river starts. It starts way up in the White Mountains. How many people are familiar with the Old Man of the Mountain? Yeah, so great stone face that once hung out on the side of one of the White Mountains there and sadly fell off in 2003. But the lake it fell into, Profile Lake, that's where our river starts. So up there it's called the Pemigewasset, and that river travels down through central, one of these works, there we go, through central New Hampshire, joins up with the Winnipesaukee River, draining the largest lake in New Hampshire, where they come together at Franklin. That's where they become the Merrimack. And then it travels due south, gets down just across the Massachusetts border, and takes a hard turn to the left, as things often do in Massachusetts. It's my debate night, you know, political statement there. And then eventually spills into the Atlantic at Newburyport. In that 115 miles, the river drops about 269 feet. So that means every mile the river is dropping about 2.5 feet. Well, for the little stretch around Lowell, it doesn't drop just 200 feet, it drops 32 feet. It's really the whole reason that Lowell becomes an industrial city. This is a map of Lowell in about 1820, 1821, and you see this is the bend of the Merrimack River that we saw in the photo just a moment ago. And if you look around, it's mostly farmland, hardly any buildings there. In 1820, there are only 200 people that lived in the whole area that would later become Lowell. It is largely a farming community. There are a couple of big farms, Fletcher's, Tyler's, and Cheever's Farm here. Some woodlots, some orchards, and mostly farming fields. Down along the rivers, though, there are the beginnings of some industry. The Concord River, that if you follow it back, it runs right through Bedford and all the way to Concord. A couple of sawmills along the way. I think there's a sawmill in Bedford that had been established in the 17th century. So a couple of small efforts at putting together industry using the falls, the shortfalls of the Concord River have been established. It largely looks like any other, you know, sort of sleepy New England town, except for, you know, this pretty important feature, the Merrimack River that runs alongside. Now that Merrimack River, it drops 32 feet from here to here, where the Concord River comes back in. Most of that drop takes place at the Pawtucket Falls. That's today's School Street or Mammoth Avenue Bridge. It's about 15 or 16 feet of it drops there. And that's great news for the earliest people who are here, and those are the Native American groups that are using the falls to catch shad, salmon, alewives that are migrating up the rivers. This is from a little bit south of us, but a good representation of the sort of weirs that they might have set up to catch those migrating fish. But for the settlers, the colonial settlers that are here, that Pawtucket Falls is just a nuisance. They're using the river for something else. They're getting logs down from northern New Hampshire, sending them on down the river, And they're heading them out to the shipyards that are at Newburyport. They're going to become the masts on the ships there. And when they got to the Pawtucket Falls, they'd have to pull those logs out of the water, tie them up to oxen teams, drag them overland, and then drop them back in the river on the other side. It's a huge hassle, such a hassle that those shipyard owners get together in the 1790s, and they decide to dig the Pawtucket Canal. And that's the canal that you see running right here. It's a little more than a ditch, 8 feet wide, about 4 feet deep, but enough to get the logs around the falls and eventually barges of goods, sending goods down from northern New Hampshire out to Newburyport, put them on ships and send it down to Boston. And it's pretty successful. In about 1803, it's put out of business by another better canal that's about a mile upstream. Some of you might be familiar with the Middlesex Canal, and that connects the Merrimack River directly up to Boston, 27-mile shot. Now, if you have barges of goods, you're not going to send it to Newburyport and put it on a ship and send it to Boston. You're going to send it directly. And the Pawtucket Canal loses a lot of business. That Middlesex Canal, by the way, if you don't know, comes out right about where the Bunker Hill Community College is today. There's a kind of low area where there's a lot of rails, so I think an Amtrak center there. But that was the receiving bay for the Middlesex Canal. So our canal starts to fall apart, people aren't using it, and it would have been lost to history had it not been for the capital part. So there are some Boston businessmen that realize that they can harness this canal system and the drop in that river for something else. Our story of capital starts with this guy. Anybody recognize him? No. We don't have any portraits of him. Kind of sad. He is Francis Cabot Lowell, after whom Lowell is named. Francis Cabot Lowell was a Harvard graduate. He had worked as a merchant, you know, famous family, the Lowells in Boston. And in the early 18-teens, he decides to go to England. Shipping isn't doing so well, heading into the War of 1812, and he's concerned about the family business and wondering what he can maybe do next. And he thinks about going into manufacturing. The problem is we don't have all the technology. We don't have the power looms that will allow us to weave the threads into cloth. England has that technology, and they're not going to let it leave. Well, they don't want the competition. So if you're a textile worker, you can't leave the country. If you have plans for the looms, you can't leave with the plans. And they searched ships to make sure people weren't escaping with those plans. So Francis Cabot Lowell goes to England and tells him that he's there for his health. You know, he's part of a respectable family. They invite him into the mills. He wanders through, looks at these looms. What they don't realize is that he has a near photographic memory. And he is memorizing the workings of each one of these power looms. He comes back to the United States. His ship was searched perhaps as many as three times. He doesn't have plans because they're all up here. Comes back here and then in Waltham, Massachusetts, a little west of Boston on the Charles River, he works with a very talented mechanic named Paul Moody, and he recreates the loom that he had memorized back in England. And there he sets up the Boston Manufacturing Company. This is the first factory in all the world to take all the steps of cotton cloth production and put it under one roof. In England, they had towns, spinning towns, where you spin the thread, then you send it to another town, weaving towns, where they weave it into cloth. Here, the spinning machines, the carding machines, the looms, all the steps of the process under one roof. And it's a master stroke of genius. He's making a lot of money, has complete control over the whole process. And if you're a businessman making money, what do you always want to do? Make more money, right? So he wants to expand. The problem is the Charles River only drops 7 feet. It's not enough to power all of the water wheels he has running all of those machines. He needs a place that has maybe a bit bigger drop. And so he goes looking for that place, but unfortunately dies. But his investors who had gone in on with him on the Boston Manufacturing Company, kind of loosely known as the Boston Associates, they would find that place they were looking for. This is four of them from left to right. That's Abbott Lawrence. His brother was president of Harvard. Kirk Boot from England. He's the military engineer of the bunch. He's the guy that knows how to build canals. Then we have Patrick Tracy Jackson. He has a lot of the money, as does the guy on the right, Nathan Appleton, all of whom have things named after them in Lowell and around Massachusetts today. All of these folks are the Boston Associates because they live in Boston on Beacon Hill. They've all gone to Harvard. They're all buried in Mount Auburn Cemetery. So this is the sort of Boston Brahmin set. So these folks would come up to Lowell, and they would find that bigger drop. They would harness the 32-foot drop on the Merrimack River. They would take that Pawtucket Canal, and they would enlarge it. Previously 8 feet wide, 4 feet deep, and now you have a much larger canal, and they'd build more canals. So you'd end up with 5.6 miles of canals running through the city. And the idea is simple. You're going to just channel the water from here along the canals, and then some of that water will flow through this canal. This is the Hamilton Canal. It'll flow underneath the mill through underground tunnels, drop down about 15 feet onto water wheels, hit them, spin them. Those water wheels will spin pulleys, leather belts, drive shafts, and eventually run the machines. And that's how they harness the power of the Merrimack, the Merrimack River. Now, to build all these canals, this is hard work. And so they bring in laborers. These are largely Irish laborers that have mostly been working in filling in Back Bay in Boston. And that big job there is kind of in fits and starts. And so many of the Irish laborers are out of work from time to time. Kirk Boot, the gentleman that was the second from the left in the previous photo, recruited workers to come up and build the canals. Responding to that is a man named Hugh Comiskey. There's a statue of him. We don't know what he looked like. This is probably a good representation. He comes walking up with 30 other Irishmen, walking up the 27 miles along the Middlesex Canal, and reports for work. So for the first 5 months, Kirk Boot has these 30 guys digging what will end up being 6 miles of canals that are pretty deep, almost, you know, 20 feet deep in places, with stone walls that look like this. And they're using shovels and picks and hand carts. It's a lot of work. And after 5 months, Kirk Boot realizes 30 is not enough, hires 500 more. It would take them 17 months to finish the first part of the canal system. But today, much of their handiwork is still in place. And that's what you see in the right-hand picture there. They're really not only great pieces of engineering, because this has stood the test of time. This is some probably 190 years old. But it's also a beautiful piece of artistry. If you look at it, it's dry-laid stone masonry, no cement holding it together. Every piece cut exactly and precisely so that it fits into every other piece that's surrounding it. And it's held up just marvelously well. And those of you that have been on canal tours know that you can see this from along the canals there. One of the particularly challenging things about digging this canal, if you've ever had to dig a hole in your backyard, you ever run into something like this? Yeah. So we have two types of rock in New England, hard and harder. Yeah, there we go. a geologist, I see. So this is the Andover granite. This is the Merrimack quartzite. And these are the two types of stone that are underneath the canals. So to get rid of them in the 1820s, how do you suppose you would have done that? You build a wall, right? That's what you can do with it. But if it's a big rock in the ground, how are you going to get rid of it? You're going to blow it up. Exactly, right. And if it were 30 or 40 years later, you'd use something safe like dynamite. But it hadn't been invented yet. So you're using black powder, gunpowder. They would take a kind of star-shaped drill and hit it, and then turn it a quarter turn, and hit it, and turn it a quarter turn, and hit it, turn it a quarter turn, to drill a hole in the rock. And it would take about 7 hours, two men, to drill a hole that's about 4 or 5 inches deep. Then you're gonna fill it with gunpowder, you're gonna put a fuse in it, you're gonna light it off and run, and hope it goes off in the right direction. Sometimes it did, sometimes not so much. There are lots of people, residents nearby, that reported fist-sized stones going through their windows, going through their roofs. One couple had a 50-pound stone land right in between them in their backyard. So dangerous work for people living nearby. Imagine how dangerous for the laborers that are doing this work. They're paid about 84 cents a day. It's only a tiny bit more than the girls are making working inside the mills working on the looms. So really monumental amount of work that goes into building Lowell's canal system. But once they have that established, this kind of just shows you how it worked, right? On the left-hand side, there's our water wheel, water just flowing in, dropping down, dropping into the buckets of the water wheel and spinning it. On the bottom left, you have, that's actually a wheel from the Wilkinson Mill in Pawtucket, Rhode Island, where they had one of these that still operates. That's about what it looked like. Gives you the person there for scale. And then there's just kind of a diagram that shows you the water wheel on the bottom, the leather belts running all up and down through the different levels of the factory and operating the machinery. So these mill owners, they wanted to control every part of the process. Not only did they build mills, but they wanted to make their own machines, the looms that they were using, and the water power machinery. So the first thing they built is a manufacturing company, the factory, the Merrimack Manufacturing Company. The second thing they built was the Lowell Machine Shop. That was where our visitor center parking lot is today. Not a trace of it remains, but there they're building looms, they're building the water power machinery, even building their own locomotives to move the cloth in and out and get the raw material in. This is a remarkable operation in business until the 1930s, and this is one of those sort of global impacts that Lowell has. In the 1890s, Lowell Machine Shop is so well regarded and so good at what it does and can do it so effectively and cost effectively, when China is setting up its first fully automated cotton textile mills, they get all of their machinery from the Lowell Machine Shop. So 1892, we like to think we had a role in China's industrial revolution, for good or bad. So if you're familiar with Lowell, you would be now on top of what is today the American Textile History Museum or the Lowell Sun Building. If you're looking from the corner of Thorndike turning into Dutton Street, just coming off the Lowell Connector, that's what we call Swamp Locks Gatehouse. That's where our boat tours start today. This is a foundry. None of it's there today. This is where the new $175 million trial court will be built. They'll be breaking ground September of 2010, or 11, or 12, or 17, something like that. So, tremendously successful operation. This is the representation of one of those factory complexes. Carol, I'm still in the screen, right? Okay, all right. So this is the factory building set up on the left-hand side here. This is the canal with water flowing through. It flows through underground tunnels underneath the courtyard, goes into these factory buildings, drops down that 15 or 16 feet, runs the water wheels, spits out to the river on the other side. Today's Boot Cotton Mills is still here. These buildings are still there. They've just been added to and built around, but they're that factory complex from the 1830s is still intact today. Anybody any questions so far? The mill owners started their building in the 1820s, and they end up building 10 big manufacturing companies. By 1850, they have 120 manufacturing buildings. They have a tremendous number of workers there. The city's now a city of 33,000 people. And what they noticed is there isn't enough water in the river. They keep running out of water. So many factories are built, and they're pretty successful. They're making a lot of money. If you run out of river water, though, you don't have any power source. Now you have your workers sitting idle. All of that investment is just sitting there. You need power. And so they bring in a pretty high-powered engineer. They brought him in at the age of 18, though. This is James B. Francis. He had come here to work on a railway in southern Connecticut at the age of 17. At the age of 18, he works for the Locks and Canals Company, the company that operates the water power system in Lowell. He would end up staying for 50 years in Lowell. And when the chief engineer died, Francis was 22 years old, and they said, "You're a pretty good draftsman. I think you'll be chief engineer." They knew him as the chief of police of water, always chasing the water down, getting it to go where it's supposed to go. Very responsible for a lot of the innovations that make Lowell successful. And this is one of his most important. He realizes that the water is coming from someplace. And if we don't have enough water, maybe we can change, we can go to the source and get more water from that source. So he goes up into New Hampshire, and he goes to the hydro dam that's at the opening of Squam Lake, where they filmed On Golden Pond. And then he goes to Newfound Lake in Bristol and to Lake Winnipesaukee, the two dams there. And he negotiates with the companies that own those dams, and he purchases them on behalf of the Lowell Mills. So now they own those dams. And whenever they need water, they can just telegraph up there and say, "Open up the dam." And the lake level goes down, flows into the Merrimack. 3 days later, that water shows up in Lowell. So great system. New Hampshire not super excited that all of its lakes are sort of operating at the behest of the Lowell Mills. And Lowell at the time also has a competitor, and that is in Manchester, the big Amiskeag mills that are, you can still see driving along the highway today. And that Amiskeag mills, that's right along the Merrimack River. So the Lowell owners went to the Amiskeag owners and said, you know, we're going to buy up all these dams. So maybe you want to go in with us on that and help us out with that purchase, because you're going to benefit from the water coming down there too. And what do you think the Amiskeag mills said? Yeah. So doesn't the water have to go by us anyway? Yeah. And the Amiskeag mills can take as much water as they want as long as they put it back in the river. And so they benefit from the purchases that the Lowell mills make up there in New Hampshire. So that solves some of the water power problem. But James Francis has something else that he does. I'll talk about it a bit later with the technology. So all of this work and all of this capital that's poured into Lowell transforms the city from a really kind of bucolic small factory village being set up in the middle of this kind of natural scene where farmland and woodlots had been, and that's 1834. This is Lowell in 1850. Now by 1850, a city of 33,000, the second largest in the state, gone from 200 people to 33,000, 12,000 workers, 10 big manufacturing companies. They're manufacturing about 160 miles of cloth every single day. So really remarkable transformation. And this is Lowell of the 1870s. So just 50 years after farmland and woodlots into this new kind of teeming, hustling, bustling industrial city, the likes of which people hadn't really seen before. A whole city built to manufacture cloth and all of the support industries and housing that goes along with that. Lowell would become a model for other cities like Lawrence and Manchester and Nashua, up and down the Merrimack River Valley, and then eventually up and down the eastern seaboard. Imagine if you lived here, and in the space of one lifetime, from farmland and there's a neighbor way down the street, to a city that looks a lot more like Lowell does today. So tremendous transformation in the landscape. That wouldn't have happened without labor, and that's our next critical stream. Lowell has a kind of interesting place, and we celebrate the story of the workers, and in particular, Lowell's famous mill girls. The owners of the mills went up into northern New England and recruited amongst the farm families in New Hampshire, in Vermont, and Maine. At the time, the farms weren't doing so well, and for decades, generations, it would have happened here in Bedford too, one farm would pass from one generation to the next, and your 300-acre farm is split up amongst three sons, and you have 300-acre farms. And the next time, it gets split up again, and the farms get smaller and smaller, less productive, less efficient. But all the way along, people and families still have a kind of survival strategy of creating big families to work on the farms. And so in northern New England, by the time we get to the 1820s and the 1830s, we have lots of big families, lots of small, not very productive farms, lots of people without anything to do. And in particular, the women there that weren't allowed to work in many of the different kinds of professions or occupations that might have been open to men. For women, often you could work as a domestic housekeeper or work as a schoolmistress or a couple of other fairly narrowly defined job opportunities. So the mill owners thought this was the perfect opportunity. We can hire, we have machines, we don't need people that, these are machines that we don't need skilled workers for, so we don't need people that already have skills. We can pay the women a little bit less, and that will be acceptable, and there are a lot of them up there that might be willing to come down and work for us in Lowell. So they send the recruiters up and bring the farmers' daughters that are between 16 and 24 years old, although 16 to 30 wasn't terribly uncommon. You can imagine if you're a parent up there and a recruiter comes up, send your 16-year-old daughter down to Lowell, this new industrial city. It'll be fine. What do you think? Yeah, maybe not so much. So they establish a couple of institutions that make this work. One of the crucial ones is the church. There hadn't been a church in the area that would later become Lowell. So as far as we know, this is the first church in the country built not by a group of parishioners, but by a company. This is St. Anne's Church. This is St. Anne's Episcopal Church. And Kirk Boot, one of the gentlemen I mentioned earlier, he's in charge of this building project, and he decides that I need a church in order to recruit these women to come down and work. So I'm going to build one. Does he build one, a congregational church in the, you know, the faith and the denomination of most of the mill girls? Nope. He's from England. He builds the Episcopal Church, the church that he would recognize from being at home. And it is modeled after the church that he was married in Derby, England, which, by the way, he wanted to name Lowell Derby instead of Lowell. He didn't win. So he builds a church. So this is one institution. And about a year and a half later, there is a congregational church that's built. So churches are sort of critical components of creating institutions that make the labor force possible. The other crucial component is on this, we just saw this a minute ago, on the right-hand side, there are all these buildings. These are boarding houses. There had been no place to live. This was farmland, right? So if you're going to bring a lot of workers down here, you need a place for them to live. So the companies built rows and rows and rows of boarding houses. But not only just rows and rows of boarding houses, in each one of those, there was a boarding house keeper. And it was her job to be a kind of surrogate parent. She'd watch after the girls. She'd make sure that they're in at curfew time, make sure they go to church on Sunday. She's going to feed them. She's going to make sure the laundry is done. Gentlemen callers will be supervised in the parlors. So really acting as a kind of surrogate parent. And this is the sort of the other half, the other institution that makes this a kind of acceptable idea for those parents up in northern New England. And they would begin to send their daughters down to Lowell by the tens of thousands. These are those boarding houses in about the 1890s. You still see them right along the canal just on the other side of the boot cotton mills. And here's one of the few that survive. Today we have set up as a museum that you can visit. Inside, they're really pretty comfortable places. People expect a kind of tenement that's in there, but they're really nicely appointed. This would have been pretty crowded, though. You know, probably 30 or 40 girls living in each one of the boarding house units. But you see the piano there. And this highlights one of the other reasons that this is an attractive opportunity, not only for families to send their daughters here, but for the daughters themselves. They could come down to Lowell, and because the Lowell mill owners, they had been to England. They had seen places like Manchester and the dark satanic mills, as they're often described by Dickens and others. They didn't want to recreate that in Lowell. So they have a kind of streak of idealism. They want to create Lowell as a place for profit, but also a place that's an uplifting opportunity for the girls to come and work, to learn a little something, to go back greatly morally, spiritually, and intellectually improved. So those mill owners went in and helping to the girls purchase pianos for the boarding houses. Charles Dickens visits in 1842, remarks that he's really impressed that so many of the boarding houses have pianos that are in them. This is a Chickering that we think Nathaniel Hawthorne might have played. It came out of the wayside and they were getting rid of it, so we have it in our boarding house there. But the mill owners also brought lecturers in from Boston, people like Ralph Waldo Emerson and Henry David Thoreau and Edgar Allan Poe. I guess they're coming from Concord, not from Boston. You see here, there are photography studios. The girls would be able to enjoy the camaraderie of other girls their own age. Working back on the farm, you might not see another girl your own age. It might be miles away. So here they are. These are Lowell girls, photographs of them in about the 1860s. Hmm? Well, they don't, and that's because of photographs in the 1860s. You'd have to stay still for several minutes, and you just can't hold a smile like that, so they're all sort of grimacing there. And who knows? You know, people have looked at these and said, well, you know, it's a silent statement about their working conditions. By the 1860s, they weren't great. They're all holding the shuttles, though, so it's sort of indicative of here's the tool of the trade, right? And this is the thing that's giving me this new life that allows me to take a photograph of myself there. It's not something that I would have had the opportunity to do before. So it'd be interesting, you know, it's interesting to look at these and wonder what they're really thinking. They're not uniforms, it's just that's the fashion. You know, it sort of looks like that on the right-hand side, but as far as we know, there aren't any of the mills that have any kind of a uniform. Typically, the girls would show up in the mills and they would be wearing their homespun that had been created back home on the farm, and there are many accounts of girls getting made fun of because they're wearing, you know, this sort of backwoods homespun material, not the fancy new stuff that's available in the stores that are in downtown Lowell. So very quickly, the girls would make their own purchases. And you can imagine making that first purchase with money that you earned yourself. It's really quite an exciting moment. But it also marks you as being part of this new society and not, you know, the new person that just came in off the farm there. I hadn't noticed that they're all almost exactly alike, though. There. There was a sail, right, yeah.
Are the overhead lights dimmable?
What was that?
Are the overhead lights dimmable to make the pictures a bit crisper?
I don't know.
They are, but the problem is, in filming this for Bedford Cable, if we dim the lights, we cannot see the speaker.
Oh.
So I'm sorry about that.
I'm fine with that. All right, so those are those guys I talked about. The mill owners also supported the first all-female written, edited, and published magazine in the world. And it was published in Lowell. It's the Lowell Offering, publishing accounts of girls' lives in the factories. Because it's supported by the factories, as you might expect, it has a glowing review of what life in the factories is all about. It's a wonderful thing. You should come and work here, too. Some of which was probably really quite sincere, some of which less so there. But interesting to see that many of the authors that write for the Lowell Offering go on to become authors of some fame and repute on their own, poets and people like Lucy Larcom, after whom a park in Lowell is named today. So this is one of the things they're supporting. The other thing, they're very conscious that they're bringing the girls in from the natural world, from nature, into this new kind of artificial city. And because they're doing that, and they don't want to recreate a Manchester, they're very consciously recreating a bit of nature inside the city. This is the courtyard in between one of the boarding houses, and here I put this in here because you see the big trees that are there. Those aren't accidents. Those are planted on purpose by the mill owners. The mill owners built long parks along the canals in the 1830s. They're thinking about green space in the city 30 years before Frederick Law Olmsted ever thinks about a Central Park in New York City. It's just remarkably early for that kind of foresight. They set aside two big areas of parkland, the North and South Common, still there today in the city. And along one of the canals, they create the Northern Canal Walkway, an opportunity for the girls to get out there on Sundays when the mills are closed and to parade, promenade along in their new, finest clothes they purchased, kind of an opportunity for, I guess, conspicuous consumption, showing off the new fashions and the new world that they're part of. So an interesting part of how Lowell evolves. One thing they don't show you here, on Sundays, because the mills are shut down, they drain the canals to service them, and the Irish laborers are in there shoveling out whatever's ending up in the bottom of the canals. So they set these up so that the girls could be out there promenading on Sundays, and that's exactly the time when the canals are drained at their ugliest and all the laborers are down there with the girls, I don't think it worked out as well as they had intended. So all of those amenities were great, but it is largely the cash incentive. Most of the girls have come from a barter economy in northern New England, hardly any cash going around. Here in Lowell, they're paying cash. And unlike other industrial cities, they don't have to spend it at a company store. It's cash that they can spend on their own wherever they want to spend it. It's not a lot of cash. On average, they're making about $3.50 a week. They're paying about $1.25 for their room and board. If you think about it today, it's a little more than a third of their income for room and board. It's probably not that out of line with what we'd pay today. Of course, everybody has a lot less stuff, so things cost a little bit more. On average, a fancy hat is about $2, so that's about a week's income. A book was about a dollar, so you'd save up for a while and make a nice purchase. Many of the girls would save a lot of money. One of the banks was established just to provide bank accounts for the girls, and many of them would go back home with $100, $150, enough even to purchase a house back up in northern New England. So really great opportunity that they wouldn't have seen back at the farm before. So Massachusetts has a law that requires residents of a town, if the town so votes, to contribute basically a pew tax, right? There's an establishment of religion in Massachusetts until 1833 when it's removed by law. So this isn't something specific to Lowell, but there is a 37.5 cent pew tax that's paid, I think that is monthly. That does go to the church, and the girls are required to attend church as a condition of employment. If they go to the church, they have to contribute this as the tax there. So it does amount to that. Essentially, they're assessed an amount and required to attend church there. If they didn't attend church, you're violating one of the regulations, lots of regulations, and you might be fired, kicked out, and blackballed from other factories. All of the owners of these different mills, they all work together. In many cases, it's the same investors that own this mill and that mill and that mill, and word would get around. If you violated the regulations, if you decided not to attend church, then you wouldn't be invited into any of the other mills, and you'd simply have to head back home or to one of the other cities, like Lawrence or Manchester, until word got around there as well. So lots of regulations. There are curfews. You have to go to church on Sundays. And you're under the watchful eye of the of your overseer, the boss of the mill, the agent lives right next to you. So it's a very, very heavily regulated society. It's one of the costs of living there. One of the other things is the long work days. So as much of a great opportunity as it was, it's just a really, really long, laborious sort of the drudgery of factory work. There's a timetable on the left-hand side, kind of hard to make it out. So at 4:50, the last bell rings. So that's there, it rings at 4:30 to wake you up, and at 4:50, you better be on your way to the mill, because at 5:00, you've got to be at your machine, ready to clutch it in and start it working. You work for 2 hours, and then you break for breakfast. You have 35 minutes. The bell's going to ring. You're going to stop your machine. You're going to walk down about 85 steps down a spiral staircase, walk across the bridge, over the canal, all the way to the boarding house, sit down. You're going to get served your meal with 40 other girls at the same time in that dining room, all trying to get as much as they can as quickly as they can. And then 35 minutes later, you need to be back over at the mill, back up the stairs, back at your machine, ready to turn it on. And if you're not, they're going to lock the gates behind you. You're not going to get back in. You're not going to get paid for that day. 12:30, same thing happens for lunch or dinner. Then you're back again 35 minutes later, and then you break for the day at 7:00. That is, if you do the math, 12 hours and 50 minutes of labor. Yeah. So it's a long day. And it changes a little bit over the course of the 19th century, but there's no doubt about it. These are very, very long hours. You work 6 days a week. On Saturday, sometimes they cut out a few hours early. So Sunday is the only day you're guaranteed to have off. And these are difficult working conditions. If you've been inside the weave room that we have at the boot mill, this is a picture from the 19th century. This is the weave room that we have today that's still operating. These were hot places, 85 degrees, 90 degrees. In the summer, 100 degrees, 110 degrees. Humid, about 85% humidity. Kept that way intentionally so the little fibers on the threads don't break. If they all break, you're going to have to stop the machine and tie them together. And you've got about 40,000 threads you're responsible for, so that's going to not be a good day. So the humidity is kept up pretty high. Lots of cotton fiber in the air that you're breathing in all day long. They would get weaver's lung, brown lung disease. Doctors call it bisonosis. The fibers would get into your lungs and the air sacs. They'd fill them up, and you just lose the capacity to breathe. People visited Lowell around the turn of the 20th century, talked about how everybody they talked to was gasping and wheezing for breath, didn't think much of it because that's just how everybody else was breathing as well. So really serious conditions and really challenging work environments. And dangerous too, with all the leather belts that are running through there, potential for your hair to get caught or clothing to get caught there. I pushed that button quicker than I thought. So the mill girls are working throughout most of the early part of the 19th century. They slowly give way to a lot of immigrants that begin to come into Lowell, willing to work for lower prices, willing to work under worse and worse conditions. By the end of the 19th century, it's mostly immigrants that are working in the mills. Many of the Yankee mill girls had gone home, and that's how it continues up and through about the 1920s, and really until the mills finally close in the 1950s. So our last stream is technology and the innovations that go into making Lowell happen. And I just want to highlight two people and some of their contributions. This guy's Paul Moody. So I mentioned him earlier. He works with Francis Cabot Lowell in putting together the loom. I think Francis Cabot Lowell said, I remember there was this thing that went like this and this thing, and Paul Moody's the guy that built it and made it work. There's a great replica of that over at the Charles River Museum of Science and Industry in Waltham today. But then Paul Moody came up to Lowell to work for the company here. And lots of patents and lots of innovations, but one of his most important is this. This is how looms, power systems had operated in factories for a long time, since the Industrial Revolution begins in England. You have the water wheels on the bottom, and those water wheels spin big metal gears. Those metal gears mesh with other gears. They turn drive shafts that go up to the next floor, run another set of gears, and then the drive shafts go up to the next, and then another set of gears. So this is all metal drive shafts, metal gears running throughout the mill. It's very heavy, it's very expensive. You have metal on metal, which creates sparks in a cotton fiber filled, oil soaked wooden floored mill. If it breaks, you're out of commission for weeks because it's really expensive. You don't keep extras of these on hand, so you have to have them manufactured in a foundry. So it's just not an ideal system. And Paul Moody says, well, couldn't we just do this with leather belts? And that's what he does. He runs leather belts on big pulleys running up and down through the different floors in the factory. And it's a very successful system, him and another man named Ithamar Beard. And they come up with this style of moving the power around the mill. And this really marks the difference between American manufacturing and British manufacturing for most of the 19th century. British is mostly using still those big drive shafts and the gears, and American industry uses these leather belts. So it really changes American industry and starts right in Lowell. Has an unintended consequence, though. By the 1870s, there is so much leather that's being demanded by factories, so many factories that have grown up in the United States, that we run out of cowhide. Where we have to go to South America and to the Argentine pampas and get cowhide imported from there, and that's very expensive. But in the 1870s, just as that's happening, there's another great source of leather that's suddenly become available. The idea is 1870s. Railroads going out west.
Buffalo.
Yes, right. So the American buffalo, American bison, the American buffalo. And so the American buffalo, bison, there are 25 million animals, about, estimates vary, in the 1870s. By the early 1890s, there was something like 1,200 animals. And that decimation of an entire species, complicated reasons for it, but one of the big driving forces is the tremendous demand for leather by American manufacturers that are using that leather belting system. So, not what Paul Moody had in mind, but kind of good illustration of unintended consequences of some of these innovations that change the way things work, and some of the environmental costs to industry that we might not think about, right? And that it's only years later that we understand the costs. But tremendous innovation that comes out of Lowell. This is the other guy, James B. Francis. So he's our engineer we had met earlier. He buys up the dams up in northern New England. He also comes up with a new kind of dam. Others had done this, but not quite on this large scale. This is the Pawtucket Dam. This is 1,093 feet long. This is the dam that holds back the water and pushes it into the canal. And you look at the top of it, and what is it made out of? Wood, yeah. So kind of a strange thing to make a dam out of. The idea here is the higher the water drops from, the more energy it will have when it drops down and hits the water wheel. So the power you get from it is based on the height of that water. The higher the dam, the more power you have. So you'd want a dam to be as high as possible. The only problem is, the higher the water is, if the spring rains come along and the water starts to flood, now you're flooding people's yards, farmers' fields, and other buildings that are upstream, and now you have to pay damages to them. So ideally, you want a dam that's high when you want it to be, but then drops down when there's flooding. So that's the dam that he builds. It's called a flashboard dam. And it looks a bit like this. The top of that dam, it's granite running all the way across. And you can see the granite blocks in the bottom part of it. And then at the top of it, there are iron rods. They're 5 feet long, about an inch and a half wide. They weigh about 40 pounds apiece. There are 680 of those in the top of that dam. And then behind those rods, there are wooden boards. Those wooden boards add now 5 feet of height to the water behind the dam. So now you have 5 feet more water, 5 feet more power that's there. Well, that's great. Works when the mills need that power. What happens in a flood? Well, the water, if it gets high enough to go over the top of that flashboard, the pressure, the force, the energy of that water is enough to actually bend those iron rods right over. And as it bends over, our wooden board flies out, drops into the river, picks up, we pick it up at Nashua, 7 miles down the river, and the water level goes down to the top of the dam. Right. So great solution. So now you've alleviated all that pressure. You're not going to flood upstream. You don't have all of those the damages there. It's physics. It cannot fail. It works on the force of the water. Great system, except for now what? Right. So to fix this, you're going to row out in a barge, and you're going to take out each one of these iron rods, and you're going to bring them to a blacksmith shop, and you're going to heat them and hammer them straight. And then you're going to bring all 680 of them back out and put them in the top and put those wooden boards back into place. And you can't count on it being the nicest of weather when you do it. Here they are, 1924, on the top of the dam. You can see them standing there with ice floes all around them, knee-deep in that water, flowing all around them, removing those 680 iron pins. These are the locks and canals guys. The workers in Lowell, the workers in the textile machines, the mill girls get a lot of credit for being the workers of Lowell. These guys are doing a pretty hard job as well. And they have a kind of deal. If you get swept over the dam and downstream while you're doing this job, you get an extra day off. Yes. I don't know if that's still the deal, but it is still the case that they manage the dam that way today. The company is now, it's a hydroelectric company called Enel. They're a multinational Italian company. They get in a barge. There's a barge. I took this photo about 6 months ago. They row out to the dam and pull the pins out. Now they use a hydraulic press and bend them straight, but they bring them back out, line the boards back up, and they're ready to go for the next time there. It is one of the largest dams that's still managed in this way. And if you want to see it, take a look at it now, because it will be changing. We'll be building a new dam. It's just like the dam in Lawrence. It's called a bladder dam. And it has a granite on the top and has a ramp. It has an airbag that inflates, and that lifts it up or lowers it down. Right? And so that's the new kind of dam that they're going to be building. The National Park is not excited about that. We like our historic dam that James Francis built in 1875. This will require them cutting into that historic dam, really changing the aesthetics of it. Now the water sort of flows through the dam and the leaky flashboards. It's a really dramatic sight. Beautiful thing to see the Pawtucket Falls. No water will come through this new dam. And it's also, this is just physics. This has stuff that can fail. Right. And so for that reason, we're not as excited about it as others are. So if you like this cool historic engineering, it is a national civil engineering landmark. Go and check it out while you can. So tremendous innovation. One of his other great innovations, if you've been on our boat tours, you've probably seen this. He has an enormous portcullis gate, a huge 21-ton wall of wood. It's in the top of the picture there, designed to close off the canal system in the event of flooding. He built this in 1850, so there it is, hanging from that building above. It's 27 feet wide, 25 feet tall, 21 tons. It's held in place by an iron shackle. You just chisel away at the shackle, and when it bursts, you can drop that down into the canal, and it blocks the canal off in the event of flooding. He started to build it in 1850, cost $10,000. It's like $250,000 today. People said, that's just dumb. I don't think a flood is going to come along that's high enough that's going to be warranted, and that's a lot of money to spend. James Francis knows what he's doing, pretty good engineer, doesn't have long to wait to try it out. 1852, it's one of the worst winters on record. In April, they have 4 days of warm rain, and suddenly the waters of the Merrimack are 14 feet higher than the dam. And he would use this gate. He would have it dropped, and indeed it would save the city. He was honored as a great genius, having saved the city with this dam that everybody made fun of. They made a silver pitcher. There's a picture of our boats going underneath it there. A silver pitcher in his honor. And I show this particularly, this terrible picture from a 1930s newspaper, because it's missing. If you have this on your mantle, let us know. It's 2.5 feet tall. It's a pretty big, solid silver pitcher. It has engravings about James Francis and pictures of the Great Gate that are on it. It was around in the 1960s. It was supposed to go to a museum. It doesn't seem to have gotten to the museum. It's a mystery. We don't know where it is. It's James Francis's 200th birthday this year, so we want to find it. So if you've seen something like this, let us know. So just to give you an idea of the flooding that does happen from time to time, this is a picture of that building off to the right is the blacksmith shop where they bend those iron rods straight and that you can see the dam that's there. Well, remember what that blacksmith shop looks like, and I'll show you a picture of the 1936 flood, and there it's that building that's right in the center, right? So the water right up to the top of that. For the 1936 flood, the water crested 20 feet higher than the Pawtucket Dam. So one of the worst floods ever to hit Lowell, and again, they used that wall, and again, it would save the city. So tremendous innovation that Francis has there. And today we have a wall of steel instead of that wall of wood. We don't use it any longer, but we do have big steel logs that we drop into place with cranes, and that's what it looks like there with the frame. In 2006, the Mother's Day flood, we had to use it. Then there's the water underneath that bridge and the wall holding those waters back. So turns out a wall of steel, just as good as a wall of wood stopping the water. One difference though, 14 hours to put the steel wall in place, 25 minutes to chop away at the shackle there. So. Fortunately, meteorology is a little bit better. So the last innovation I'll just touch on quickly. These are the water wheels that I mentioned that run the mills. They're not very efficient. They're only about 64% efficient. That's how much of the energy of falling water it can convert into mechanical energy for use in the mill. And in the 1840s, as they're running out of water and James Francis is buying up the dams up there, he's also thinking, can I find a new way of getting more energy out of the water? Maybe I can develop a different kind of water wheel. And so he takes a French design and refines it and takes that water wheel and develops what's called the Francis turbine. On the right-hand side, it's really just a water wheel turned on its side with the vanes bent a little bit. It's just like the pinwheel that I have here. It's really exactly the same thing. Instead of water, but it comes down and hits those vanes and pushes them and turns them. Well, this turbine is about 85% efficient, so it increases the amount of energy available to the mills tremendously. And it's such a good design that it becomes known as the Francis turbine, and today Francis turbines power about 1/5 of the world's hydropower in places like Grand Coulee Dam and in Hoover Dam. Three Gorges Dam in China, the largest hydroelectric project ever in the world, is run by Francis turbines, the style and design of which was pioneered right here in Lowell. And the very first Francis turbine we have, it's intact. It can't be used anymore, but it's in one of the buildings in the park. So another example of the kind of remarkable innovation that comes out of Lowell and ends up affecting industry throughout the country and throughout the world. So we have all of our streams that come together, nature, capital, labor, technology, to create a new kind of industrial city that would really shape industrial America in the 19th and the 20th century. And that's what we celebrate at the park. 1978, Lowell National Historical Park was established. Jimmy Carter signed the legislation. There's Paul Tsongas off to the right, congressman, later senator, of course, Senator Ted Kennedy off to the left. Paul Tsongas, really critical support in developing the idea of the park and bringing it to fruition and getting that through Congress. And now through the park has been able to leverage the stories and history of the city, the culture of the immigrant groups that have come there over the years to work in the mills, but who now are vibrant, dynamic communities with all kinds of cultural offerings for the city, and to use that to help revitalize the city and bring it back from the difficult situation it was in once the mills had left in the 1950s. And today you can experience a bit of that story walking around the city in places like Lower Locks, where so much of the handiwork of those 1830s Irish canal laborers is still intact, and it really just a spectacular scene with the lock chamber on the left and the gatehouse off to the right. Beautiful walkways along that Northern Canal walkway. This is where the mill girls were promenading, still there today. You could promenade if you'd like on Sundays or other days, but it's a beautiful natural walk. You're in the middle of a city of 106,000 people, but it feels like you're in the middle of this, uh, this, this this, you know, lovely green space. We have our visitor center with a new video that we just got set up that replaced a 16 slide projector slideshow. So we've come into the 21st century. We have our Boot Cotton Mills Museum with our working weave room, where you can experience the feel, the sensations of working in a factory setting. These machines are about 100 years old, and you can do that without having to stay 12 hours and 50 minutes. We have lots of exhibits upstairs in the boot mill that trace a lot of the history and a lot of the textile machinery that's still there today. That Mill Girls and Immigrants exhibit, where you can experience the home life of the mill girls and the workers coming to work in Lowell. We have our trolleys. We have reproduction trolleys created by the National Park in the 1980s. And this is one of them. But we also have real vintage trolleys. This one, a 1924 trolley from New Orleans, ran along the St. Charles Line. If you see the name of it, right? It is a streetcar named Desire. You can ride it today. It's on permanent loan from the Kennebunkport Seashore Trolley Museum. But a great way to get around the city. Really harkens back to the days when streetcars were a vital part of getting around the city and the metropolitan area in the early part of the 20th century. Our turbine exhibit, where you can actually see a turbine operating, and the gears, the 8-ton flywheel, 800-pound leather belt, how that power transmission that Paul Moody had come up with really works. Get up close and personal with a loom, and season our boat tours that run through the canals with a really unique perspective on the city, and really get to see, you know, up close and personal how this unique water power system works today. One of the amazing things about it, built to provide power in the 1820s, still being used for power today. So these canals now are connected to a hydroelectric project that powers about, creates enough electricity for about 20,000 households. But more interesting than that, the water power machinery, the turbines, are still in place in a lot of the factories. They closed in the 1950s, no need to run looms anymore, but now that same water power machinery is hooked up to generators. So the power, the water flowing through the canals today is flowing underneath the factories, running generators, and between those, they create enough power for about 7,000 households. So it's about 27,000 households powered by the energy flowing through the Lowell Canal system. And so a remarkable story, and I'd love to have you all come back to Lowell, and those of you that haven't been, come out to Lowell and see it and experience it for yourself. And I'd like to thank you for having me today, and happy to answer any questions. Well, there's a lot of stuff on the table that I didn't get to, but in the interest of time, I'd be happy to talk with any of you about some of the things that are up here. I have a leather belt that represents the buffalo hide. It's actually made out of buffalo. I have some of the implements used by the canal laborers in splitting some of the granite. I have the raw cotton, so you can see sort of what it starts like. A shuttle that's part of some of the loom machinery. Piece of cotton that's woven in our boot cotton mills there, of course the rocks and the pinwheel thing there. So, but visit us online if you like. We've got websites and we're on Facebook, social media there. And so, any questions? Yes.
Okay. I remember being up there and seeing a steam engine. Did they go to steam as a source of power eventually?
Yeah. So remember, 1840s. We're running out of water, right? So that's kind of the last part of that story. Many of the mills begin to put in steam engines as backups. Now, it's really expensive to get coal up from Pennsylvania. The rail system isn't very good in the 1840s, and it's so expensive that it's much cheaper to run the water power. But still, they put in backup steam engines. Any place you see a chimney in Lowell, that represents a powerhouse with a steam engine at the bottom. By the end of the 19th century, though, the rail system was much better, mining techniques are much better, steam engines are much more efficient, and most importantly, there's an insurance company in Hartford that will ensure your steam boiler in case it blows up. And now a lot of companies begin to turn to steam power. And so by the 1890s, you'd see more than half of them have gone to the steam power. Unfortunately, there's very little of that that's left today. We're working on trying to refurbish a steam engine to try to tell a bit of that story. But yeah, and then 19-teens, many of them will switch over to electricity. Right. So some of them create their own electricity, some of them buy it from a plant that's in the city, and put individual motors on each of the machines rather than having the whole belt system there. So it's just kind of a continuum of evolving power sources. Yeah.
So what happens, looking at the big picture, didn't from the mills, they had labor troubles and then they moved to the south? Isn't that what really happened? And were these the same owners that just moved someplace else?
So the first wave of owners, those Boston Associates, they're the owners up through about the Civil War and a little bit after. And it's during that time, Lowell becomes a victim of its own success. So successful that by the 1850s, other cities had replicated Lowell's success, like Lawrence, like Manchester, New Bedford, Fall River, Holyoke, and suddenly there's a lot of cloth out there, and the price goes down. And so now it's not quite as profitable. They can't offer the amenities they once did for the mill girls. Wages go down, boarding house rents go up, the work gets harder. And a lot of that's when a lot of the mill girls go home, and a lot of the immigrants end up replacing them in the mills. And it's at that moment that a lot of the original owners, who really had this kind of idealistic streak, always in it for the profit, but they truly had this commercial utopia idea in mind. Many of them are getting older and deciding, this is not the thing I want to do. And they begin to sell them off. And you have a much more fractured ownership in the later part of the 19th century. So by the time you get to the early 20th century, and now you have some labor unions that have finally got a little bit of traction and been able to make demands that the mill owners have had to sort of bow to, it's no longer a solid block of all the Boston Associates. They're all individual owners that some of them need to accommodate some of the demands of their workers. They're realizing this is a very expensive place to operate. And that's why in the 1920s, many of the mills moved to the south. Labor's cheaper, land's cheaper, the unions aren't quite as well organized. Child labor is a thing that is more acceptable in the South in a way that it isn't acceptable, particularly in Massachusetts, which has by then a lot of laws requiring school-age kids to go to school a certain number of hours. In the 1920s, all but three of the original manufacturing companies closed down in Lowell, and several of them end up opening versions of themselves down south. Few of them hang in there. World War II, lots of war contracts come in, like industry everywhere, but by the 1950s, they're just not able to compete, and the rest of them would close down. Ironically, of course, the same thing happens to the south. When land and labor is cheaper someplace else, they would close down there as well. Great example of that is our Boot Cotton Mills Museum. All the looms that are in there, they started out in Fall River in the Borden Mills, Lizzie Borden. So her family owns the Borden Mills indirectly. Those mills closed in the 1950s, and when they closed, the machines went down to their new mill down in Kingsport, Tennessee. And that was in operation until the 1980s. And then it closed because they couldn't compete with overseas textile production. And when they closed, it was right at the moment they were building our museum, and they had exactly the machines that we used at the boot mills. And so we ended up with all their machines. But those machines end up sort of telling the story of American industry, moving from the north to the south and then being put out of business by industries elsewhere. Yeah. Yes?
What happened to the mills during the Civil War when cotton was hard?
Yeah, kind of a problem for a mill owner. There you are on Beacon Hill, and everybody is, an abolitionist, right? This is what you're supposed to be. But that really cuts into your interest as a mill owner, right? So many of them would try to sort of ride this line, still be abolitionist, but we don't want to hurt slavery where it is because it exists there, and that institution is fine. We're just not going to support the spread of it. As the Civil War is coming, they can see it coming months off. And they begin stockpiling cotton, thinking that, we're going to be out of business if suddenly we can't get this cotton flow, which is exclusively coming from the plantation south. Interesting enough, they're the best customers, too. A lot of the cloth made up in Lowell goes down to clothe the slaves that are down there. You've got to imagine, you're a slave picking this cotton and knowing that this stuff is going up north to be made into something that's going to come back, and then, you're wearing it. So. Interesting dynamic there. So they're stockpiling cotton, and then the war starts, and England also had gotten its cotton from the plantation south. And suddenly England is nearly out of business. They don't have plantations set up in England, in Egypt and India, the way they would by the end of the 1860s because of this reason. And suddenly they're willing to pay any price for raw cotton. And the Lowell owners, almost all of them, make a decision. You know what? They're going to pay a ridiculous amount for our raw cotton. Why don't we just sell it? I mean, how long does this war last? They sell it off, all of their stocks. They're out of business, and the war lasts for 4 years. But they had sold off all of the stocks. They have a lot of money coming in. They have a labor force. Anybody who hasn't gone off to the war is still sitting there unemployed. And so they use that money and that labor as the opportunity to expand the mill complexes. It's the moment where you see individual mill buildings, like the first boot mill image that I showed you, transformed into the massive complexes that you see today. It's that 1860s, they use all that money, all of that labor, to expand. So when the cotton flow comes back by the end of the 1960s, they're really poised to take off. And the 1870s is probably the height of production, the best decade for Lowell. But out of business for the time of the Civil War. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I just want to be conscious of time. I don't know if we need to do something differently, but okay. All right. So, yep. Sure.
You mentioned the Middlesex Canal.
Yes.
Did that come before Lowell?
It came before Lowell developed as an industrial city. It came after the first Pawtucket Canal, so that's 1796. And then the Middlesex Canal comes in, I think it's 1803. Somebody might know that better for sure. It's about 1803. And so that's 20 years before the first mill is opened in Lowell. So the Merrimack Canal is used to transport a lot of the raw cotton up and the finished goods going out when Lowell is first built. Lowell has the Boston and Lowell Railroad in 1835, the first passenger railroad in New England, but it's also used primarily to ship the raw material up to Lowell and get the finished goods out. Ironically enough, run right beside the Middlesex Canal that used the canal boats to bring up the rails that would eventually put that canal out of business there. But yeah, so the Middlesex Canal was in operation before Lowell was established as an industrial city, and is an important part of its sort of early establishment.
It was built by the Middlesex Canal, was engineered by Colonel James Baldwin.
Yeah, Baldwin and Loamy Baldwin, who designs a lot of the Charlestown Navy Yard. And I wonder about those engineers, if they're talking to Kirk Boot, who's building the canal system in Lowell. Kirk Boot's a military engineer. I know he talks to somebody at the Erie Canal, a man named Myron Hawley, who's the engineer out there. I do wonder about connections between engineers, because the Baldwins are certainly famous and certainly would have known of them. I think they're still around by the 1820s.
The Baldwin house is still in
Lowell. Yeah, I think they have the statue of him there, right? Yeah.
And the canal restaurant.
Yeah, all right. Well, I'll have to eat there. And, yes?
Belts make it quieter and safer than the metal? Obviously, it was loud anyhow.
Yeah.
But was it quieter with the belts?
The belts would have been quieter. There would have been less vibration. They didn't have to build the mills quite as strong with the belt system there. One of the interesting, I talked about some unintended consequences. One of the problems with belts is originally they set them up and so they glued them together. So you have one belt like this and now you're going to stretch it around the gears there. And the problem with that is if it bound up or got caught, there's a tremendous amount of energy here before it finally bursts, and then it would lash out, releasing all of that energy, tearing across the room, running through people, machines, buildings, whatever else was there. So they realized, that's not so good. So maybe we create an intentional weak point. We're going to put staples on the ends of the belts. Staples here, staples here. And then we'll interlock them and we'll put a leather strip down the center. If it gets bound up in something and there's a lot of energy pulled out, well, it's not going to take that much energy for that little leather strip to break. And now if it breaks, maybe it'll do this rather than lash out across the room, which is great. It makes it a lot safer, sort of. Except for now, those staples are the things that are catching on hair, clothing, and some of the worst, awful, gruesome injuries that are described. And one of the more common things are workers getting something caught in the belts, and usually it's the staples, sometimes being hauled up to the top of the room and getting hurt by the gears and the pulleys there. So always trade-offs and those kinds of things. And as I said earlier, there are lots of unintended consequences. A new innovation begets some other danger or consequence. Yes.
Last one.
All right. I'd be happy to stay afterwards if anybody has any questions.
But about it being quieter.
Yes.
That's all relative because you go into the machine room now and it's all leather. You
Oh, absolutely, right, yeah. Yeah, yeah, and the wooden hammers hitting the shuttles, this is the shuttle back and forth. That's largely what the noise is. That wooden hammer is hitting the shuttle hard enough that it sends it zipping across the shuttle at about 60 miles an hour, 150 times a minute. So that's really the noise that you're hearing, that that's pretty close, right? Yeah. Well, magnified times 200 machines on a floor, and that's what you get the vibration too, especially if they all get going the same, you know, in the same rhythm, and now you really have the buildings kind of rocking there. So yes, you're right. It is all relative, quieter, but not quiet at all there. But you can experience that yourself. Come to the park, visit our Boot Cotton Mills Museum. We'd love to have you there. We're open all winter. We have a little bit more limited hours from Thanksgiving to March, but for most of the year we're open. 9 to 5 at Visitor Center, 9:30 to 5 at Boot Cotton Mills Museum. Check us out online. I've got business cards around too. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to. Yes. Oh, good. Thank you for mentioning that. I have some information, informational handouts here about Lowell. I have a self-guided walking tour of Charles Dickens Lowell when he was visiting in 1842, all the places he visited, why he loved Lowell so much, and not the rest of America, unfortunately. And then a brochure on Jack Kerouac, one of Lowell's sort of favorite songs. French-Canadian author, wrote a lot about growing up in Lowell, only becomes famous when he writes about leaving Lowell on the road, becomes a leading light of the Beat Generation. And then a brochure on Civil War Lowell. Lots of interesting Civil War connections, including the very first casualties of the Civil War are from Lowell. So if you're interested in picking any of those up, you're welcome to do that. Any questions that you have as well, and I've got my business cards as well. And I'd just like to thank you again for having me out tonight. It was a pleasure to talk with you. And